Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Eight Little Piggies, Reflections in Natural History by Stephen Jay Gould, narrated by Jonathan Sleep. A Reflective Prologue. These essays, Volume 6 in a continuing series, confront history on the broadest scale of life's evolution during 3.5 billion years. Since macrocosms are fractals of microcosms, the series also records a personal history. In the sweetest introduction I have ever received for a talk at the Academy of Natural Sciences in San Francisco, former Major League ballplayer and current eco-activist Bruce Bochte recounted my article on why Joe DiMaggio's 56-game hitting streak is the greatest accomplishment in the history of baseball. He then pointed out that I was working on a 208-monthly essay streak, also unbroken since its inception in January 1974. Over such a long stretch of adulthood, ranging from relative youth in my early 30s to distinct middle age, just past the half-century mark, many passages must be noted as the ineluctable changes of life unfold. Two aspects of ontogeny seem especially relevant to this continuing series. First, Eight Little Piggies is a book of middle life, and it does contrast entirely favorably, I think, but I'm no longer talking to my 30-something self, with my youthful Ever Since Darwin. I suppose that the major sign of this particular passage lies in my exploration of a traditional essay genre that I had previously shunned, the contemplative and highly personal ruminations in Section 4, Musings. These essays on memory, persistence, and authenticity talk about the importance of unbroken connections within our own lives and to our ancestral generations, a theme of supreme importance to evolutionists who study a world in which extinction is the ultimate fate of all and prolonged persistence the only meaningful measure of success. These essays may treat familiar themes, but at least they follow my idiosyncratic procedure of building, via oddly tangential connections, from a small and concrete item or incident to a broad generality. From sitting with my grandfather on some warehouse steps to characteristic pathways of false memory in our favorite stories, Essay 11. From a graveyard and the invisibility of a large factory in Amana, Iowa, to our need for bucolic myths and the false concept of past golden ages, Essay 12. From calling cards and a visit with a 97-year-old paleontologist who knew C.D. Walcott to the importance we place on continuity and non-vicarious experience, Essay 13. And from a breakfast in San Francisco to a taxonomy of authenticity and the role of vernacular customs and architectures in the preservation of regional diversity, Essay 14. All these essays feature our treatment and distortion of historical records, a kind of ultimate subject for any paleontologist. Second, the six volumes form a sensible series, each with a different central focus appropriate to its time in three ways: stage in my own life, reaction to current events, and position in the developing logic of an extended discourse on evolution and history. The first volume, Ever Since Darwin, 1977, centers upon the basic explication of Darwinian principles. Where else would one start? The Panda's Thumb, 1980, develops the largely unrecognized extensions and corrections of Darwinism that run so counter to many sociocultural hopes and expectations, as in the principle of imperfection embodied in the title example. Hen's Teeth and Horse's Toes, 1983, had an immediate focus that now, and happily, seems a bit outdated, but by no means dead. The attack of creation science, biblical literalism, upon teaching evolution, and our victories both in courtrooms and in cogent and decent argument. The Flamingo's Smile, 1985, emphasizes the importance of randomness and unpredictability in the history of life. This theme had a double and immediate origin at two levels: my own bout with cancer at the most personal, and the proposal and successful development of the asteroidal impact theory of mass extinction at the broadest and most general. Bully for Brontosaurus, 1991, following a longer gap for rumination and synthesis, then put the two central themes together, the mechanics of Darwinism with the unpredictability of complex temporal sequences, to form, finally, a full-scale disquisition on the nature of history and its primary theme of contingency, also explored in my intervening Wonderful Life, 1989. I like to think of these volumes as building rather than replacing. The old foci carry over and weave together, tightening up thereby and leaving room for new extensions. Yet one theme of transcendent and growing importance has been almost absent, and shamefully so, from my writings heretofore. How can any naturalist, any self-professed lover of diversity, ignore the subject of anthropogenic environmental deterioration and massive extinction of species on our present Earth? Oh, I have not entirely bypassed this central concern of my profession. Side comments and paragraphs abound, and even a full essay or two, Essay 29 on Nuclear Winter and the Flamingo Smile, for example. But I've never addressed this theme centrally and head-on. My reluctance reflects no failure of strong feelings, quite the contrary. If anything, I've desisted because my feelings are too powerful, lying in the domain that Wordsworth described as thoughts that do often lie too deep for tears, and perhaps for words as well. I have never found any distinctive words to convey these common emotions. I could not bear merely to write the shibboleths of the movement, or even worse, to emote for show, catharsis, or accountability, but with nothing different to add to the hyperabundance of current expostulations. Perhaps I have finally found something to say that might be helpful rather than only repetitive. Eight Little Piggies includes a section placed primus inter pares on the sadness of anthropogenic destruction. But if I have finally found a voice, I came to it in my usual way, entirely unanticipated and via a quirky item arising from a personal experience then adumbrated along a forest of tangents. I went to French Polynesia with my son in the summer of 1991 and learned that the island of Moorea had served as the model for Rodgers and Hammerstein's Bali High of South Pacific. I also knew that Moorea and other adjacent islands had recently experienced a tragically unnecessary extinction of a large, beautiful, and historically important fauna of land snails, the genus Partula, that had been the life's work of Henry Crampton, a great scholar of land snails who was revered within the profession, if unknown outside. My technical research is on land snails, so this is my community. Finally, I had a place to stand. By focusing on the cruel and ironic erasure of Crampton's lifelong struggle, rather than only on the animals, I could construct a humanistic reversal for the usual focus on animal victims, primary and perfectly appropriate, of course, but so often said by people with a far better sense of the necessary poetry. The Bali High setting was irresistible, especially with the titular pun of unenchanted evening. So I rented South Pacific, bless the VCR, as a new research tool, and wove a nexus of humanistic references into a piece that tries to construct a reversed, people-centered perspective on the tragedy of extinction. But I could also use the emotionalism of Ezio Pinza and his great song to end with a re-reversal and acknowledge, as must be done, the primal and primary rights of nature and her beauty. The package worked, at least for some people, of two close colleagues who had studied Partula before its extinction on Moorea. The American wrote to tell me that he'd been moved to tears, while the Englishman, from the world of stiff upper lips, wrote to inform me that his wife had cried. I then round out this first section of essays with a most general perspective, though arising from a few squirrels, based on the geologist's primary theme of timescales and their limited domains of application, Essay 2, followed by a small story about the first death of a marine invertebrate species in our times, just a tale on one level, but also a powerful symbol of impending trouble, Essay 3. If these two sections on musings and extinctions represent additions based on changing times and personal growth, aging might be a more honest description, The other six sections follow the traditions of previous volumes and tell new stories about new themes, mixed with some golden oldies in the domains of evolutionary theory and the history of life. Section 2, Odd Bits of Vertebrate Anatomy, takes four central principles for explaining evolutionary legacies and transitions and illustrates them with intriguing peculiarities of restricted parts in vertebrate anatomy. The fact that earliest land vertebrates had up to 8 digits per limb and that 5 is therefore not canonical, the eponym for this entire volume. The tailbend of ichthyosaurs, the evolution of mammalian ear bones from reptilian jawbones, and why the evolution of swim bladders from lungs, and not vice versa, as Darwin assumed, and as many texts still proclaim, is neither paradoxical nor contrary to our usual view of evolutionary sequences in vertebrates. Vox Populi, title of the next section, is a double entendre. My essays on the central works of individual scientists have always been my personal favorites. They are, literally, vox populi as essays about individual scientists. But the title also recalls a trenchant line from Darwin, where he argues that the old motto of vox populi vox dei, the voice of the people is the voice of God, cannot apply to science. This is not a plea for elitism, but a recognition that traditional ways of thought often block understanding. All my essays on individuals try to rescue interesting and honorable, not necessarily correct, effort from the opposite dangers of historical legacy, scorn for enemies and hagiography for heroes, opposite in content perhaps, but eerily similar in debarring our sympathetic understanding. Section 5, Human Nature, treats the subject that, at least in a legitimately parochial sense, is the most pressing and important to the interface of evolutionary biology and human life. How to avoid the pitfalls of biological determinism and its unfortunate legacy in social use, and the simple silliness of sociobiology when done in the strictly adaptionist and speculative mode, still the canonical form in pop culture and not at all rare in professional literature, and to discover what our biological heritage and the principles of evolutionary change truly have to tell us about the nature of our mentality and behavior. The next two sections treat the main body of evolutionary theory, but in a personal and iconoclastic spirit. Section 6 on broad patterns in time, and Section 7 on basic Darwinian theory and some important revisions. Section 6 is divided into two parts. The first, Essays 21 and 22, stand together as a duet and try to present a coherent case for the central role of sensible unpredictability as the major feature of life's history. Essay 21 sets out the necessary and sufficient major condition, and Essay 22 forges a double whammy by adding an equally powerful theme that makes the result even worse for those committed to conventions of progress and predictability, but ever so much more fascinating for those who wish to grasp the richness of sensible history. The second pair of essays continues the wonderful and rapidly developing story of surprises in documenting the vast anatomical explosion that heralded the first flowering of multicellular life. The essays of Section 7, Revising and Extending Darwin, may be the most challenging in the book, but this subject, too often ignored in popular presentations, cannot be bypassed by anyone who wishes to grasp the depth of evolutionary theory. The low road, too often taken, merely speaks of the power of natural selection and leaves listeners with the cardboard view that evolution may be equated with the building of nicely working organic machinery. This section treats principles additional to, and in important ways restrictive of, natural selection, internal constraints, and historical legacies, Essays 25 through 27, and randomness as a force for change, not merely as a source of raw material for natural selection, Essay 28. Evolution is much more than a story of matching form to local environments, with increments of general progress slowly accumulating through time, the usual view of pure Darwinian functionalism. Any genealogy is a complex tale of interplay between these Darwinian themes and a set of forces based on the internal genetic and developmental architecture of organisms that produce different historical patterns and conceptual meanings. The material may be more difficult, but I've tried to approach this vital subject by concrete example. The coloration of pigeons, fishtails, and frog calls, different ranges of morphological variety in domesticated dogs and cats, and the eye tissue of completely blind mole rats. Perspectives that are reversed or orthogonal to traditional modes form my stock in trade. I've long argued that conceptual locks are far more powerful than factual lacks as barriers to scientific understanding. About 20 years ago, I got an idea for such a reversed book on the history of evolutionary thought. I would describe this science via the organisms studied rather than the folks so engaged. Instead of chapters on Lamarck, Cuvier, Darwin, and Mendel, I would write about trilobites, ammonites, and Tyrannosaurus. For a variety of reasons, I never pursued the project to full fruition, but I still like the idea, and putative chapters can stand as full essays. The last section, Section 8 on Reversals, offers two such chapters. Essays 29 and 30 are a miniature Rashomon, two different perspectives, one based on specimens, the other on iconography, on three major worldviews applied sequentially to the study of cephalaspis, most famous of the earliest vertebrates. I generally try to expunge redundancy when I gather these several years of monthly essays into a single collection, though I have allowed two pieces to finish with the same wonderful last lines of Darwin's Origin of Species. But in the duet of essays 29 and 30, the redundancy is studied and intentional, for a pair of such different looks at the same story carries its own power, just as the great Japanese film taught us. The last essay, A Foot Soldier for Evolution, tells the story of a clam studied by nearly every important evolutionist from Lamarck on. The title is a double entendre, as organisms are the rank and file of this grand history. My main reason for planning such a book, for history by organisms must be more democratic than chapters on people, where we are driven to rank from Darwin down, and clams in particular are Pelecypoda in technical parlance, meaning hatchet foot, and therefore truly foot soldiers. The epilogue to this essay provides, at my expense, the most important of all lessons in science, and a fitting end to the book. All these essays first appeared as columns in my monthly series, This View of Life, in Natural History Magazine. I regard this volume as a true natural selection, since many have been dumped and the others improved and then organized into a sensible and coherent sequence, more organic than linear in its webs of cross-referencing. The many that I now dislike or regard as substandard are on the scrap heap, so I will stand by all items in the present winnowing and reshaping. But some, inevitably, please me more than others, or at least serve as better exemplars of my chosen style. I think that I am condemned to like best the essays that are most difficult or most focused on particulars of little public knowledge or approbation. I am not hopelessly rarefied or ethereal, and I do feel quite warmly towards some of the most evident, if vital, themes and homely illustrations, as in Musings on Distortions of Memory and Myths of Past Golden Ages, essays 13 and 14. But I do so wish that some of the more complex pieces could receive some share of attention. I especially like essay 29 because focusing on specimens rather than scientists so well highlights the crucial duality of all scientific activity, tension between the necessary social embeddedness of all scientific thinking and progress towards more adequate factual knowledge of an external reality, by pathways often tortuous and circuitous. If everyone knew the beauty and oddness of actual cephalaspis fossils, this essay would be a sure winner, but knowledge is a prerequisite for this kind of love. For this reason, we need more hands-on science education, and we must resist the terrible current trend to confuse museums with theme parks, wonderful things in their proper domain, and to replace real specimens with large, throbbing, blinking glitz in order, ultimately, to pack more bodies into the gift shop. Also, please study Essay 25, even if you revile pigeons. C.O. Whitman was one of our greatest biologists, and the key theme of his pigeon work really does speak to the nature of mind as a product of evolution. I adore all the odd animals and anatomical bits that I pack into these essays, but I've always liked my people pieces best. My favorite essays in the last three volumes are the titular bishop of Titiopolis on Nicholas Steno in Hen's Teeth and Horse's Toes, Adam's navel on Gauss's bizarrely magnificent treatise Omphalos in The Flamingo Smile, and In a Jumbled Drawer on the conventional career of N.S. Shaler and the iconoclasm of William James in Bully for Brontosaurus. People ask how I keep finding honorable intent in reviled characters by the simple expedient of rediscovering either the full logic of their argument or the social context of their claims. Are all thinkers so worthy of respectful resurrection? Of course not. Many are reviled in their own time for good reasons that remain equally cogent today. For the most part, I don't choose to write about these people. I praise Archbishop Usher, Essay 12, so falsely labeled as a unique reactionary shoving his finger into the crumbling dike of revealed religion in order to hold back the flood of science, when he actually represented a large research tradition, humanistically motivated and successful in its own terms, though wrong about the age of the earth due to a false premise at the core of the argument. I warm to a paranoid dyspeptic like Eugene Dubois, Essay 8, when he fairly sticks to his guns in a noble, if losing argument, but when posterity, not even trying to grasp the subtlety, invariably reports that he finally labeled his precious ape man a giant gibbon, although he actually, by this trope of argument, and when you grasp his full system rather than picking at isolated straws, tried to affirm the immediately ancestral status of his Homo erectus. But the saints often need intellectual resurrection as well, though I'd rather be misunderstood in clouds of celestial music than bubbles of boiling magma. Halley is so tied to his eponymous comet that his work on the Earth's age is largely ignored and usually interpreted ass backwards when mentioned at all, Essay 11. Goethe's oracular reduction of all plant form to a leaf archetype needs to be read for its unconventional form of scientific excellence, Essay 10. I also like to find unusual entrees to important subjects generally treated under conventional formats. Thus, I approach Darwin's personal views on race and sex, not by analyzing the descent of man, though I do not ignore this primary document, but by studying his very first publication, an article with Captain Fitzroy on the moral state of Tahiti, Essay 18. As for the hottest topic of modularity in cognitive science, I never found a distinctive way until I learned that an English dilettante named Daines Barrington had published an article in England's leading scientific journal on Mozart's musical abilities as a child of eight. Barrington wrote when young Wolfgang represented a generic prodigy and had not yet become, so to speak, Mozart. Thus, he could be presented as a type, a general puzzle in why musical ability could be so hypertrophied in an otherwise ordinary boy. All this, in the propitious time of Mozart's bicentennial year, led me to Darwin on Mind, Tinbergen on the evolution of behavior and cognition in general, my own puzzling over Michelangelo's stunning effect in using modularity to carve his statue of Moses, even via Monty Python and back to Mr. Barrington on the literary convention and odd name of Lightites to mask wonderment, thus giving me a string to tie my beginning to a stylistically gentle end. Not bad. I often wonder what I'm doing every month. I can't be just a dilettante or poseur, or the streak wouldn't be continuing with such undiminished commitment and ardor, such love of each little new thing learned. I guess I see myself in the guise of Papageno, the birdcatcher of Mozart's magic flute. He captures, but does not harm, the most beautiful objects of nature. He is capable of naive wonder, counting as originality and breaking through conventional prejudice. As when frightened by the Moor Monastados, he stops and upbraids himself. How foolish! Blackbirds exist, so why not black men? He wins at the end the greatest Darwinian prize of continuity, as he finally gets his Papagena and the promise of many little Papaginos and Papaginas to follow. I think of them as essays, but do not doubt his overwhelming modesty amidst all the showy confidence. I sense how rich and complex it is out there, and what a tiny, tiny part any of us has been able to understand. and I feel much like Papageno as he struggles to sing but can produce no words, though he hums a lovely melody, because his mouth is padlocked. Nonetheless, if I could have but one Mozartian wish, although it will be as unrealistic as the original claim itself, and although this series will stop Deo Volenti in January 2001, I would request the time to write as many monthly essays as the Don had women in Spain. Ma in España. 1. The Scale of Extinction. 1. Unenchanted Evening. Tahiti is the stereotype, virtually the synonym, of enchantment in our legends. Nurse Forbush from Little Rock might have been a charmer, especially when played by Mary Martin, but the South Sea locale made a strong contribution to Some Enchanted Evening, and Ezio Pinza, the greatest of operatic Don Giovanni's slumming on Broadway, didn't hurt the scene either. Some aspects of the legend need correction. Point Venus, for example, still the landing spot for many tourists, is not named for the beauty of Tahiti's women, but for astronomy and Captain Cook, who set up his instruments at the site to measure the transit of the planet Venus across the disk of the sun in 1769. Charles Darwin himself was beguiled both by the name and the place when he arrived on the Beagle in November 1835. We landed to enjoy all the delights of the first impressions produced by a new country, and that country the charming Tahiti. A crowd of men, women, and children was collected on the memorable Point Venus, ready to receive us with laughing, merry faces. Darwin, however, broke ranks with male convention in expressing a lack of enthusiasm for Tahiti's women. I was much disappointed in the personal appearance of the women. They are far inferior in every respect to the men. He objected most of all to the current fad in coiffure. An unbecoming fashion in one respect is now almost universal. It is the cutting of hair, or rather shaving it, from the upper part of the head in a circular form so as to leave only an outer ring of hair. The missionaries have tried to persuade the people to change this habit, but it is the fashion, and that is sufficient answer at Tahiti as well as at Paris. Darwin's heterodox judgment had not been widely shared. Captain Bligh, who got such a bum rap from Charles Lawton, may not win any medals for grasping human psychology, but he was a great seaman and no more dictatorial than the normal run of British shipmasters. The celebrated mutiny on his bounty owed as much to Fletcher Christian's longing for Tahiti and the women he left behind as to any of Bligh's shipboard policies. Tahiti may be beautiful, but the title for Picture Perfect Paradise has usually been awarded, and rightly so in my judgment, for I've just returned from my first visit to French Polynesia to the neighboring island of Moorea. Located just 12 miles northwest of Tahiti, Moorea is an extinct volcano with a soaring crater rim deeply dissected by later erosion into jagged peaks and draperies. Seen from Tahiti, especially when enshrouded by its usual entourage of seemingly personal clouds, Moorea becomes a most fitting symbol of beauty combined with mystery. One day on Tahiti, Charles Darwin scaled a local peak and received his dose of Moorea's spell. From the point which I attained, there was a good view of the distant island of Aimeo, the old name for Moorea. On the lofty and broken pinnacles, white massive clouds were piled up, which formed an island in the blue sky, as Aimeo itself did in the blue ocean. This impression of beauty and mystery has certainly persisted. Oscar Hammerstein used Moorea as his model for Bali High, the off-limits paradise of delight in South Pacific. Bali High will whisper, on the wind of the sea, here I am, your special island. Come to me, come to me. Who could resist these enticements, especially for a few francs and a 40-minute ferry ride? So my son Ethan and I visited Moorea on our recent trip. We were not disappointed. Unfortunately, the lure of Bali High has attracted other guests, some not so harmless. This essay is a story of genocide in paradise, a preventable wholesale slaughter just completed in one human generation. You do not know the tale only because it pitted snail against snail rather than man against man. but do not breathe a sigh of relief for moral exculpation of our species. Snails killed snails, but humans imported the agent of death, consciously and for decent motives, but with tragic and easily avoidable misperception. Oceanic islands are our great natural laboratories of evolution, the source of so many ideas about organic change and of so many classical examples from finches on the Galapagos to flies on Hawaii. The combination of geographic isolation and difficult access, with frequent absence of predators or competitors, provides explosive possibilities for creatures who manage to reach these bounteous havens. On the Galapagos, for example, finches radiated into a series of ecological roles usually filled by several families of birds on continents. Some species eat seeds of varying sizes, others act like woodpeckers. One species uses cactus needles to pry insects out of crevices. Darwin was bamboozled during his celebrated visit and classified these birds into several groups. He only learned the true story and significance when a professional ornithologist surveyed his collection in London and recognized the anatomical signature of finches beneath all the diversity. Land snails provide some of our finest and most intensely studied examples, and for obvious reasons. Few manage to make the long and fortuitous ocean voyage by such odd means of transport as natural rafts, mud on birds' feet, or hurricanes if the distances are not too great. The lucky immigrants often find an open world divided into numerous separate pieces, the islands of a chain, each available for colonization and each the eventual source of an evolutionary radiation. Moreover, with their legendary lack of range and their hermaphroditic nature, small founding populations of snails, right down to the absolute minimum of one, can readily become the source of isolated colonies and eventually new species. One rat on an island is a transient memory, unless she is a pregnant female. One snail, any snail, may be the progenitor of a vast and changing population. The high islands of the Pacific are the most promising places of all, for they combine maximal isolation with ecological diversity, the full range from seashore to volcanic mountaintop. Many of these islands are formed by single and fairly symmetrical volcanoes. The volcano sides are often dissected into a series of radiating valleys from crater rim to sea. Since most land snails prefer moisture, they often live on the valley floors, but not on the intervening ridges. This common geography adds yet another ingredient to the evolutionary cauldron, a source of isolation within islands as each valley becomes its own separate pocket. On the most diverse of oceanic islands, almost every valley may house a separate species of a particularly prolific snail. The great radiations of Pacific Island land snails are a glory of evolution and a source of joy and knowledge to those of us who have followed Darwin's footsteps into a profession. I must confess to some jealousy here, for I've devoted my career to the less diverse land snails of low Atlantic islands, to P. salazonites on Bermuda and Cirion on the Bahamas. Darwin's own Galapagos house a classic example, more than 60 endemic species of the family Bullimulidae. Even more famous, to cognoscenti, for I do not expect a general murmur of recognition here, are two great radiations on more isolated central Pacific islands, the several hundred species of Acatenellidae on the Hawaiian Islands and the 100 or so species of the genus Partula on Tahiti, Moorea, and their far-flung neighbors. These high island Pacific snails occupy an honored place in the history of evolutionary thought as foci for one of our great and extended debates. No animals seemed better suited for resolving a major issue about causes of organic change. What is the role of environment in evolution? In particular, do organisms change their form to fit altered conditions? And if so, does environment work its influence directly by Lamarckian inheritance of characters acquired during life, or does form map environment through the indirect route of Darwinian adaptation by natural selection of the most fit in a random spectrum of variation? Against these two different versions of adaptation, Lamarckian and Darwinian, other evolutionists asserted that form would not match environment in any clear way. The grossly maladapted will die, of course, but if variation arises only rarely and in definite directions, and if most alternates are well enough suited to local environments, then adaptation will not shape the differences among populations. Internal causes, direction of rare mutations, rather than external shaping by natural selection, will then predominate in the production of evolutionary change. What better test of these issues than the high island Pacific snails? For if every valley housed a different population, think of the natural environment thus provided. Many valleys would have nearly identical environments, but be colonized by only distantly related snails. If adaptation ruled and climate shaped evolution in predictable ways, then the different snails of separate but similar valleys should evolve strong likenesses as adaptations to common conditions. But if internal factors predominated, then no correlation of form and environment should be found among populations. John T. Gulick, 1832-1923, son of an American missionary who worked in Hawaii, fired the first important salvos in a series of works published between 1872 and 1905. Although Gulick spent most of his adult life as a missionary in China and Japan, he had, as a young man in his parents' parish, amassed an enormous collection of Hawaiian akatanelids. Gulick came down strongly for internal factors and against control by natural selection or any other form of environmental influence. He could find no correlation between the forms of shells and the local environments of their valleys. Places with apparently identical vegetation, moisture, and temperature might harbor shells of maximally different form. Gulick, who so strongly opposed, and primarily for religious reasons, the dominant determinism of the late 19th century, triumphantly concluded that the unpredictability of snail shells could be fully generalized to an overall defense of contingency in history, including human free will. If my contention that different forms arise in identical environments is in accord with the facts, the assumption which we often meet that change in the organism is controlled in all its details by change in the environment, and that, therefore, human progress is ruled by an external fate, is certainly contrary to the fact. From Gulick's famous 1905 treatise, Evolution, Racial, and Habitudinal. When I first quoted this line in my PhD thesis of 1969, I did so with derision and as a firm adaptationist. 20 years later, I'm not so sure that Gulick was wrong in his implication. I still feel that his personal religious motive has no place in science, but people often reach correct answers for wrong or illogical reasons. The contingency of history, both for life in general and the cultures of Homo sapiens, and human free will, in the factual rather than the theological sense, are conjoined concepts, and no better evidence can be provided than the experimental production of markedly different solutions in identical environments. In any case, Gulick's conclusions drew a storm of protest from Darwinians. Alfred Russel Wallace, most committed of strict adaptationists, retorted, and not without justice, that Gulick's supposedly identical environments might only seem so to humans, but would appear markedly different to snails. It is an error to assume that what seem to us identical conditions are really identical to such small and delicate organisms as these land mollusks, of whose needs we are so profoundly ignorant. The exact proportions of the various species of plants, the numbers of each kind of insect or of bird, the peculiarities of more or less exposure to sunshine or to wind at certain critical epochs, and other slight differences which to us are absolutely immaterial and unrecognizable, may be of the highest significance to these humble creatures, and be quite sufficient to require some slight adjustments of size, form, or color which natural selection will bring about. In 1906, after reading Gulick's monograph, Henry Edward Crampton decided to enter the fray and to devote the remaining 50 years of his career to an immense study of Partula on Tahiti, Moorea, and surrounding islands. Crampton, 1875-1956, had done excellent work in experimental embryology and studies of natural selection. This earlier effort led to a slight preference for adaptation, but Crampton maintained an open mind and was prepared to support Gulick's internal factors against Wallace's shaping by environment should the evidence warrant. Crampton made 12 expeditions to the Pacific and published 3 magnificent monographs, probably the finest work ever done on the evolution of land snails, collectively entitled Studies on the Variation, Distribution, and Evolution of the Genus Partula, Tahiti in 1917, Other Islands in 1925, and Moorea in 1932. In short, and to summarize a half century of effort in a sentence, Crampton came down firmly on Gullick's side. He could find no evidence that the forms and colors of Partula could be predicted from surrounding environments. Identical climactic conditions seemed to evoke different solutions time after time. Crampton interpreted the differences between snails in adjacent valleys as results of three major causes: isolation, mutation, congenital factors in his terminology, and adaptation by natural selection, with only a minor role for Darwin's favorite mechanism. He viewed the first factor, isolation, as a disposing precondition rather than an actual cause. Geographic separation produces nothing directly, but establishes an independent population in which new features may spread. He saw the third factor, natural selection, as primarily negative. Once new features arise by some other mechanism, natural selection may eliminate them if they prove unworkable, but the source of creative change must lie elsewhere. Crampton, who was one of the first American biologists to recognize the importance of Mendel's work, located this source of creativity in his second factor of mutation, or internally generated change by congenital factors. In any environment, hundreds of possible anatomies might work, and the forms and colors of this particular population in that specific valley are fortuitous consequences of the largely non-adaptive mutations that happen to arise and spread in an isolated population. The resulting pattern of differences among valleys is largely non-adaptive. Every local race must avoid elimination by natural selection and is fit in this negative sense, but its particular features represent only one in a myriad of workable possibilities, and any particular solution arises by the happenstance of mutation in an isolated population, not by natural selection. Crampton contrasted the greater importance of mutation over selection in writing about Partula on Tahiti. The role of the environment is to set the limits to the habitable areas or to bring about the elimination of individuals whose qualities are otherwise determined, that is, by congenital factors. How can we assess the importance of Crampton's work 60 years after his last great monograph on Partula from Moorea, 1932? I am biased, to be sure, for snail men, I am one, revere Crampton as a kind of patron saint. But I rank Crampton's Partula studies among the most important in the history of evolutionary biology for three major reasons. First, he was probably right in his central claim about the non-adaptive nature of most small-scale differences in form and color among snails of adjacent valleys. Evolutionary biology went through a phase of strong belief in strict adaptationism in the generation just following Crampton, and his works did suffer a temporary eclipse. But his three great monographs are winning new respect and attention in our current, more pluralistic climate of opinion. Second, Crampton must gain our highest admiration, verging on appropriate awe, for the sheer dedication and effort of his immense labors. I spent only a day in a rented car on Moorea, and scarcely ventured out of the shade or off the paths, but I still nearly passed out from sunstroke. Crampton spent months on 12 separate expeditions, all in an age of ships and horses, not to mention Shank's mare, rather than airplanes and rent-a-cars. In the charming understatement of conventional, objective scientific prose, Crampton wrote but one small comment on working conditions. Fieldwork in such a region of Polynesia presents difficulties that are common to most tropical areas. Steamship lines ply between only the principal ports, from which excursions to neighboring islands must be made by cutter, whaleboat, or canoe. At times, it is possible to procure horses. Almost without exception, however, the exploration of a valley can be accomplished only on foot, owing to the steep declivities to be traversed, the deep streams to be forded, and the absence of any trails whatsoever in the thick forest and undergrowth of the areas inhabited by Partula. But Crampton also recorded the countervailing pleasures that keep us all going. The experiences incidental to the active life necessitated by such work were many, varied, and interesting, but the present monograph is not the place for a description of the beautiful islands or of their delightful inhabitants. Suffice to say that the days and nights of arduous and sometimes dangerous effort included hours of keen enjoyment, for the island of Tahiti especially is of matchless beauty, while the chiefs and their families offered abundant hospitalities which it was a privilege to enjoy at the time, as it is now a pleasure to acknowledge them. Moreover, Crampton's labor only began with collecting. He then spent years measuring his snails, some 80,000 for the Tahiti monograph and a whopping 116,000 for the Moorea work, and calculating statistics, all of which, incredibly, even for his day, he did personally and by hand. No computers, no handheld calculators. When Crampton speaks of calculating machines, he means those old mechanical jobbies that performed division by successive subtraction and clanked away for minutes to perform simple operations. Again, he wrote in understatement, "The author is personally responsible for every direct measurement and for every detail of classification. Hence, the personal coefficient is uniform throughout the entire research. In computing the standard deviations, fractions were carried out to 8 decimal places. The length of time required for such quantitative analysis can be estimated only by those who themselves have engaged in such work. These figures, together with a single line of text, may be all that represents 2 to 8 weeks of mathematical drudgery. Yet the employment of such methods is justified in the final results. Third, and most important, ultimate judgment must reside in a criterion of utility. All good science is accumulative. No one can get everything right the first time. If Crampton's monographs were only monuments to past efforts and ideas, they might still be admired, but only as items of human paleontology. They are, in fact, precious mines for continuing revision and extension. I know this in the most personal way, for I've used Crampton's tables, the product of his years of mathematical drudgery, in at least 3 of my technical papers. To put this crucial point in another and stronger way, Crampton spent 50 years documenting the current geographic distribution and variation of Partula on Tahiti, Moorea, and nearby islands. This work has great and permanent value as a frozen snapshot, but Crampton's half-century should be but a transient moment in the future history of Partula. Crampton devoted this lifetime of effort in order to establish a baseline for future work. Partula would continue to evolve rapidly, and Crampton's baseline would become a way station of inestimable value. No scientist could view such dedication in any other light. Future changes have much more value than current impressions. And Crampton's plan paid off, or so it seemed at first. 3 of the world's finest biologists of land snails took up the study of Partula in the next generation, building explicitly on Crampton's work. Brian Clark of the University of Nottingham, Jim Murray of the University of Virginia, and Mike Johnson of the University of Western Australia. They have published numerous papers in varying combinations of authorship from the mid-1960s to the present day. Working primarily on everyone's favorite island of Moorea, they have made important revisions to Crampton's conclusions and have added great sophistication in mathematical procedures, now computerized, and genetical methods not available to Crampton. In 1980, Murray and Clark ended an important paper, The Genus Partula on Moorea, Speciation and Progress, with these words. Although we cannot yet reconstruct exactly the evolutionary history of the Moorean taxa, they have already revealed in exceptional detail the pattern of interactions between incipient species, and have presented some fascinating paradoxes. They offer both a museum and a laboratory of speciation. Add snails to Burns's litany about the best laid plans of mice and men. Great expectations die quickly on the bonfires of human vanity. We are only a decade from these brave words of 1980, but Moorea is no longer a laboratory for studying active speciation in Partula. It has become a mausoleum. Think of all the metaphors you know for little things made worse by attempted solutions that cascade to even greater problems. For you need this apparatus to grasp the exportation of Partula on Moorea. Think of Pandora's box. Think of the old woman who swallowed a fly in the folk song. She then swallowed a spider to catch the fly, a bird to catch the spider, a cat to catch the bird, and up the size range of the animal kingdom, each successive verse gets longer as singers run through the full range of ingestions, but the last is stunningly brief. There was an old lady who swallowed a horse. She died, of course. Partula eats fungi growing upon dead vegetation and poses no threat whatever to agriculture. Its only and slight impact upon the native economy is entirely positive, as women string the shells together to make leis for the tourist trade. But animals introduced onto isolated islands often play havoc both with native organisms and with agriculture. Witness the rabbits of Australia, and to cite the most dangerous creature of all, the humans who wiped out so many species of moas on New Zealand. An introduced snail began the sad chain of destruction on Moorea. In sharp contrast with the benign Partula, African tree snails of the genus Acatina are, in almost all cases, unmitigated disasters. First of all, they are gigantic, as snails go. Second, they are voracious herbivores of living plants, including many agriculturally important species. With their clear record of destruction on island after island, I'm amazed that people still introduce them purposefully. They are brought in for food, for I'm told that they are succulent, and you do get a lot of meat per creature. Acatina was first imported to the Indo-Pacific realm in 1803 by the governor of Reunion, who brought them from Madagascar so that a lady friend could continue to enjoy snail soup. They escaped from his garden and devastated the island. By 1847, they had reached India. By the 1930s, they began to spread into South Pacific islands, usually by purposeful introduction for food. Acatina fulica reached Tahiti in 1967 and soon spread to neighboring islands. By the mid-1970s, the infestation had become particularly serious on Moorea. The snails even invaded human dwellings. One report tells of a farmer who removed 2 wheelbarrow loads of Acatina from the walls of his house. Admittedly, something had to be done, but que faire, as they say, in this very French land. The attempted solution, like the horse ingested to catch the fly, created greater havoc than the original problem. Biological control is a good idea in principle, better a natural predator than a chemical poison, but predators, particularly when introduced from alien places and ecosystems, may engender greater problems than the creature that inspired their introduction. How can you know that the new predator will eat only your problem animal? Suppose it prefers other creatures that are benign or useful. Suppose, in particular, that it attacks endemic species, often so vulnerable for lack of evolved defenses in the absence of native predators. Biological control should therefore be attempted only with the utmost caution. But speaking of folk songs, and citing a more reverent composition than the old lady and the fly, when will they ever learn? In my personal pantheon of animals to hate and fear, no creature ranks higher than Euglendina, the killer or cannibal snail of Florida. Euglendina eats other snails with utmost efficiency and voraciousness. It senses slime trails, locks onto them, and follows the path to a quarry, then quickly devoured. Euglendina has therefore developed a worldwide reputation as a potential agent of biological control for other snails. Yet, despite a few equivocal successes, most attempts have failed, often with disastrous and unintended side effects, as Euglendina leaves the intended enemy alone and turns its attention to a harmless victim. Forgive my prejudices, but I know what Euglendina can do in the most personal way. Biologists can get quite emotional about the subjects of their own research. I spent the first big chunk of my career, including my PhD dissertation, working on a remarkable Bermudian land snail named P. salazinites. This Darwin's finch among mollusks is the only large land snail that reached Bermuda. It radiated into a score of species in a great range of size and shapes. The fossil record is particularly rich, but at least 3 species survived and were thriving in Bermuda when I began my research in 1963. Euglendina had been introduced in 1958 to control Otala, an important edible snail that escaped from a garden and spread throughout the island as an agricultural pest. Same story as Acatina and Partula on Moorea. I don't think that Euglendina has even dented Otala, but it devastated the native P. salazinites. I used to find them by thousands throughout the island. When I returned in 1973 to locate some populations for a student who wanted to investigate their genetics, I could not find a single animal alive. Last year, I relocated one species, the smallest and most cryptic, but the large Piscelezonites bermudensis, major subject of my research, is probably extinct. Thus, I feel the pain of Jim Murray, Brian Clark, and Mike Johnson. They'd published papers on Moorean Partula since the mid-1960s. They never expected that their last pair of articles would be awake. Euglendina was introduced to Moorea on March 16, 1977, with the official advice and approval of the Service de l'Economie Rurale and the Division de Recherche Agronomique, despite easily available knowledge of its failures and devastations elsewhere. Euglendina ignored Akatina and began a blitzkrieg against Partula, more thorough, rapid, and efficient than anything that Hitler's armies ever accomplished. When my colleagues wrote their first article about this disaster in 1984, Euglendina had already wiped out one of the seven Partula species on Moorea and was spreading across the island at a rate of 1.2 kilometers per year. Moorea is about 12 kilometers across at the widest, and you quickly run out of island at that rate. My colleagues made the grim prediction the Partula would be completely gone by 1986. One hates to be right about certain things. In 1988, Jim, Brian, and Mike published another note with a brief and final title, The Extinction of Partula on Moorea. Partula is gone. My colleagues managed to collect six of the seven species before the end, and they have established captive breeding programs in zoos and biological research stations in several nations. Perhaps one day Partula can be reintroduced into Moorea, but Euglendina must be eliminated first, and no one knows how this can be done. Deep grafts, whether physical or emotional, are hard to extirpate, as Mary Martin discovered in her unsuccessful attempt to wash that man right out of her hair. Hope remains in Pandora's box, but how do you re-enclose the bad guys? Moorea may be the Bali High of our dreams, but life for Partula has become an unenchanted evening. Now night has fallen. The story would be sad enough if only Moorea and Bermuda had fallen victim, but Euglendina is spreading just as rapidly on the larger adjacent Tahiti, and Partula now survives in only two valleys. The even more diverse Akatanella is gone, or nearly so, on Oahu, largely for the same reason, although the spread of Honolulu hasn't helped either. More than half the species of bulimulids are extinct on the Galapagos. It is so hard for an evolutionary biologist to write about extinctions caused by human stupidity. Emotions well up and extinguish rationality and writing. What can be said that hasn't been stated before, with great eloquence and little effect? Even the good arguments have become clichés, as corny as Kansas in August, as normal as blueberry pie. Let me then float an unconventional plea, the inverse of the usual argument. Inverses often have a salutary effect in reopening pathways of thought. An undergraduate friend, during my year in England, a brilliant debater, had to argue the affirmative in that tired old cliché of a subject. This house believes that the monarchy should be eliminated. Instead of trotting out the usual points about the Queen's expense account and the negative symbol of royalty in a democratic age, my friend claimed that the monarchy should be eliminated because it is unfair to monarchs and their families. All possibility of a normal private life evaporates. You can't have a date, drink a beer, or God forbid, even belch in public without a headline in next day's scandal sheet. The extinction of Partula is unfair to Partula. This is the conventional argument, and I do not challenge its primacy. But we need a humanistic ecology as well, both for the practical reason that people will always touch people more than snails do or can, and for the moral reason that humans are legitimately the measure of all ethical questions. For these are our issues, not nature's. So I say, let us grieve for Henry Edward Crampton when we consider Partula on Moorea, for Euglendina and human stupidity have destroyed his lifetime's dedication. Crampton visited the Pacific a dozen times when transportation was no aerial picnic. He tramped up and down the valleys, over the dangerous precipices, in intense tropical heat. He spent months and months measuring snails and toting up columns of figures sans computer, the worst part of scientific drudgery. He published 3 great monographs on Partula. The work is of great and permanent value in itself, but Crampton did not write for personal glory or to establish the frozen evolutionary moment of his own studies. He labored all his life to provide a baseline for future evolutionary work. Partula was a natural evolutionary laboratory, and he toiled to establish a starting point with utmost care and precision so that others could move the work forward and continue to learn about evolution by tracing the future history of Partula. What is more noble than a man's intellectual dedication, a lifetime of perseverance through the Scylla and Charybdis of all field biology, occasional danger, and prolonged tedium? Crampton's work is now undone, even mocked. Grieve for his lost and lofty purposes. Yet I also appreciate that we cannot win this battle to save species and environments without forging an emotional bond between ourselves and nature as well, for we will not fight to save what we do not love, but only appreciate in some abstract sense. So let them all continue, the films, the books, the television programs, the zoos, the little half acre of ecological preserve in any community, the primary school lessons, the museum demonstrations, even though you will never find me there, the 6 a.m. bird walks. Let them continue and expand because we must have visceral contact in order to love. We really must make room for nature in our hearts. Consider one last image of Etziopinza as a mille de bec in South Pacific and accept the traditional characterization of nature as female. If this convention offends you, then make nature male and fall in love with a wonderful guy. The words may be banal, and Pinza was only extolling Mary Martin while I speak of all nature, but the emotional setting is incomparable and still can bring tears to any unjaded eye. Think of this greatest of bassos as he soars up to the tonic of his chord. Once you have found her, never let her go. Once you have found her, never let her go. 2. The Golden Rule, a proper scale for our environmental crisis. Patience enjoys a long pedigree of favor. Chaucer pronounced it, "An high vertu certien," the Franklin's tale, while the New Testament had already made a motto of the Old Testament's most famous embodiment. Ye have heard of the patience of Job, James chapter 5, verse 11. Yet some cases seem so extended in diligence and time that another factor beyond sheer endurance must lie behind the weight. When Alberic, having lost the ring of the Nibelungen fully 3 operas ago, shows up in Act 2 of Götterdämmerung to advise his son Hagen on strategies for recovery, we can hardly suppress a flicker of admiration for this otherwise unlovable character. I happen to adore Wagner, but I do recognize that a wait through nearly all of the Ring cycle would be, to certain unenlightened folks, the very definition of eternity in Hades. Patience of this magnitude usually involves a deep understanding of a fundamental principle, central to my own profession of geology, but all too rarely grasped in daily life: the effects of scale. Phenomena unfold on their own appropriate scales of space and time, and may be invisible in our myopic world of dimensions assessed by comparison with human height and times metered by human lifespans. So much of accumulating importance at earthly scales, the results of geological erosion, evolutionary changes, and lineages, is invisible by the measuring rod of human life. So much that matters to particles in the microscopic world of molecules, the history of a dust grain subject to Brownian motion, the fate of shrunken people in fantastic voyage or inner space, either averages out to stability at our scale or simply stands below our limits of perception. It takes a particular kind of genius or deep understanding to transcend this most pervasive of all conceptual biases and to capture a phenomenon by grasping a proper scale beyond the measuring rods of our own world. Alberic and Wotan know that pursuit of the ring is dynastic or generational, not personal. William of Baskerville, in Umberto Eco's Name of the Rose, solves his medieval mystery because he alone understands that, in the perspective of centuries, the convulsive events of his own day, the dispute between papacies of Rome and Avignon, will be forgotten, while the only surviving copy of a book by Aristotle may influence millennia. Architects of medieval cathedrals had to frame satisfaction on scales beyond their own existence, for they could not live to witness the completion of their designs. May I indulge in a personal anecdote on the subject of scale? I loved to memorize facts as a child, but rebelled at those I deemed unimportant. Baseball stats were in, popes of Rome and kings of England out. In sixth grade, I had to memorize the sequence of land acquisitions that built America. I could see the rationale behind learning the Louisiana Purchase and the Mexican Cession, for they added big chunks to our totality. But I remember balking and publicly challenging the long-suffering Ms. Stack at the Gadsden Purchase of 1853. Why did I have to know about a sliver of southern Arizona and New Mexico? Now I am finally hoist on my own petard, blown up by my own noxious charge, according to the etymologies. After a lifetime of complete non-impact by the Gadsden Purchase, I've become unwittingly embroiled in a controversy about a tiny bit of territory within this smallest of American growing points. A little bit of a little bit. So much for effects of scale and the penalties of blithe ignorance. The case is a classic example of a genre, environmentalists versus developers, made familiar in recent struggles to save endangered populations. The snail darter of a few years back, the northern spotted owl versus timber interests. The University of Arizona, with the backing of an international consortium of astronomers, wishes to build a complex of telescopes atop Mount Graham in southeastern Arizona, part of the Gadsden Purchase. But the old-growth spruce fir habitat on the mountaintop provides the central range for Tamiascurus hudsonicus gramensis, the Mount Graham red squirrel, a distinctive subspecies that lives nowhere else and that forms the southernmost population of the entire species. The population has already been reduced to some 100 survivors, and destruction of 125 acres of spruce fir growth to build the telescopes within the 700 or so remaining acres of best habitat might well administer a coup de grace to this fragile population. I cannot state an expert opinion on details of this controversy. I have already confessed my ignorance about everything involving the Gadsden Purchase and its legacy. Many questions need to be answered. Is the population already too small to survive in any case? If not, could the population, with proper management, coexist with the telescopes in the remaining habitat? I do not think that, practically or morally, we can defend a policy of saving every distinctive local population of organisms. I can cite a good rationale for the preservation of species, for each species is a unique and separate natural object that, once lost, can never be reconstituted. But subspecies are distinctive local populations of species with broader geographical ranges. Subspecies are dynamic, interbreedable, and constantly changing. What then are we saving by declaring them all inviolate? Thus, I confess that I do not agree with all arguments advanced by defenders of the Mount Graham red squirrel. One leaflet, for example, argues, "The population has been recently shown to have a fixed homozygous allele, which is unique in Western North America." Sorry, folks. I will stoutly defend species, but we cannot ask for preservation of every distinctive gene unless we find a way to abolish death itself, for many organisms carry unique mutations. No, I think that for local populations of species with broader ranges, the brief for preservation must be made on a case-by-case basis, not on a general principle of preservation, lest the environmental movement ultimately lose popular support for trying to freeze a dynamic evolutionary world in statu quo. On this proper basis of individual merit, I'm entirely persuaded that the Mount Graham red squirrel should be protected for two reasons. First, the squirrel itself. The Mount Graham red is an unusually interesting local population within an important species. It is isolated from all other populations and forms the southernmost extreme of the species' range. Such peripheral populations living in marginal habitats are of special interest to students of evolution. Second, the habitat. Environmentalists continually face the political reality that support and funding can be won for soft, cuddly, and attractive animals, but not for slimy, grubby, and ugly creatures of potentially greater evolutionary interest and practical significance, or for habitats. This situation had led to the practical concept of umbrella or indicator species, surrogates for a larger ecological entity worthy of preservation. Thus, the giant panda, really quite a boring and ornery creature despite its good looks, raises money to save the remaining bamboo forests of China and a plethora of other endangered creatures with no political clout. The northern spotted owl has just rescued some magnificent stands of old-growth giant cedars, Douglas fir, and redwoods, and I say hosanna. And the Mount Graham red squirrel may save a rare and precious habitat of extraordinary evolutionary interest. The Pinaleno Mountains, reaching 10,720 feet at Mount Graham, are an isolated fault block range separated from others by alluvial and desert valleys that dip to less than 3,000 feet in elevation. The high peaks of the Pinalenos contain an important and unusual fauna for two reasons. First, they harbor a junction of two biogeographic provinces, the Nearctic, or northern by way of the Colorado Plateau, and the Neotropical, or southern, via the Mexican Plateau. The Mount Graham red squirrel, a northern species, can live this far south because high elevations reproduce the climate and habitat found near sea level in the more congenial north. Second, and more important to evolutionists, the old-growth spruce fir habitats on the high peaks of the Pinalenos are isolated sky islands, 10,000-year-old remnants of a habitat more widely spread over the region of the Gadsden Purchase during the height of the last ice age. In evolutionary terms, these isolated pieces of habitat are true islands, patches of more northern microclimate surrounded by southern desert. They are functionally equivalent to bits of land in the ocean. Consider the role that islands, like the Galapagos, have played both in developing the concepts of evolutionary theory and in acting as cradles of origin through isolation or vestiges of preservation for biological novelties. Thus, whether or not the telescopes will drive the Mount Graham red squirrel to extinction, an unsettled question well outside my area of expertise, the sky islands of the Pinalenos are precious habitats that should not be compromised. Let the Mount Graham red squirrel, so worthy of preservation in its own right, also serve as an indicator species for the unique and fragile habitat that it occupies. But why should I, a confirmed Eastern urbanite who has already disclaimed all concern for the Gadsden Purchase, choose to involve myself in the case of the Mount Graham red squirrel? The answer, unsurprisingly, is that I have been enlisted, involuntarily and on the wrong side to boot. I am fighting mad and fighting back. The June 7, 1990 Wall Street Journal ran a pro-development anti-squirrel opinion piece by Michael D. Copeland, identified as executive director of the Political Economy Research Center in Bozeman, Montana, under the patently absurd title, "No Red Squirrels? Mother Nature May Be Better Off." I can at least grasp, while still rejecting, the claim that nature would be no worse off if the squirrels died, but I am utterly befuddled at how anyone could devise an argument that the squirrels inflict a positive harm upon the mother of us all. In any case, Mr. Copeland misunderstood my writings in formulating a supposedly scientific argument for his position. Now, scarcely a day goes by when I do not read a misrepresentation of my views, usually by creationists, racists, or football fans, in order of frequency. My response to nearly all misquotation is the effective retort of preference, utter silence. Honorable intellectual disagreement should always be addressed. Misquotation should be ignored when possible and politically practical. I make an exception in this case because Copeland cited me in the service of a classic false argument, the standard, almost canonical misuse of my profession of paleontology in debates about extinction. we have been enlisted again and again in opposition to our actual opinions and in support of attitudes that most of us regard as anathema to uphold arguments by developers about the irrelevance, or even in this case, the benevolence, of modern anthropogenic extinction. This standard error is a classical example of failure to understand the importance of scale, and thus I return to the premise and structure of my introductory paragraphs. Did you really think I waffled on so long about scale only so I could talk about the Gadsden Purchase? Paleontologists do discuss the inevitability of extinction for all species, in the long run and on the broad scale of geological time. We are fond of saying that 99% or more of all species that ever lived are now extinct. My colleague David Raup often opens talks on extinction with a zinging one-liner. To a first approximation, all species are extinct. We do therefore identify extinction as the normal fate of species. We also talk a lot, more of late since new data have made the field so exciting, about mass extinctions that punctuate the history of life from time to time. We do discuss the issue of eventual recovery from the effects of these extinctions, in the sense that life does rebuild or surpass its former diversity several million years after a great dying. Finally, we do allow that mass extinctions break up stable faunas, and in this sense permit or even foster evolutionary innovations well down the road, including the dominance of mammals and the eventual origin of humans following the death of dinosaurs. From these statements about extinction in the fullness of geological time, on scales of millions of years, some apologists for development have argued that extinction at any scale, even of local populations within years or decades, poses no biological worry, but, on the contrary, must be viewed as a comfortable part of an inevitable natural order. Or, so Copeland states, "Suppose we lost a species, how devastating would that be? Mass extinctions have been recorded since the dawn of paleontology," writes Harvard paleontologist Stephen Gould. "The most severe of these occurred approximately 250 million years ago, with an estimated 96% extinction of species," says Mr. Gould. "There is general agreement among scientists that today's species represent a small proportion of all those that have ever existed, probably less than 1%. This means that more than 99% of all species ever living have become extinct." From these facts, largely irrelevant to red squirrels on Mount Graham, Copeland makes inferences about the benevolence of extinction in general, though the argument only applies to geological scales. Yet in spite of these extinctions, both Mr. Gould and University of Chicago paleontologist Jack Sepkoski say that the actual number of living species has probably increased over time. True, but not as a result of mass extinctions, despite Copeland's next sentence. "The niches created by extinctions provide an opportunity for vigorous development of new species. Thus, evolutionary history appears to have been characterized by millions of species extinctions and subsequent increases in species numbers. Indeed, by attempting to preserve species living on the brink of extinction, we may be wasting time, effort, and money on animals that will disappear over time, regardless of our efforts." But all will disappear over time, regardless of our efforts, millions of years from now for most species if we don't interfere. The mean lifespan of marine invertebrate species lies between 5 and 10 million years. Terrestrial vertebrate species turn over more rapidly but still average in the low millions. By contrast, Homo sapiens may be only 200,000 years old or so and may enjoy a considerable future if we don't self-destruct. Similarly, recovery from mass extinctions takes its natural measure in millions of years, as much as 10 million or more for fully rekindled diversity after major catastrophic events. These are the natural timescales of evolution and geology on our planet. But what can such vastness possibly mean for our legitimately parochial interest in ourselves, our ethnic groups, our nations, our cultural traditions, our bloodlines? Of what conceivable significance to us is the prospect of recovery from mass extinction 10 million years down the road if our entire species, not to mention our personal lineage, has so little prospect of surviving that long? capacity for recovery at geological scales has no bearing whatever upon the meaning of extinction today. We are not protecting Mount Graham red squirrels because we fear for global stability in a distant future not likely to include us. We are trying to preserve populations and environments because the comfort and decency of our present lives and those of fellow species that share our planet depend upon such stability. Mass extinctions may not threaten distant futures, but they are decidedly unpleasant for species caught in the throes of their power. At the appropriate scale of our lives, we are just a species in the midst of such a moment. And to say that we should let the squirrels go at our immediate scale, because all species eventually die at geological scales, makes about as much sense as arguing that we shouldn't treat an easily curable childhood infection because all humans are ultimately and inevitably mortal. I love geological time, a wondrous and expansive notion that sets the foundation of my chosen profession, but such vastness is not the proper scale of my personal life. The same issue of scale underlies the main contribution that my profession of paleontology might make to our larger search for an environmental ethic. This decade, a prelude to the millennium, is widely and correctly viewed as a turning point that will lead either to environmental perdition or stabilization. We have fouled local nests before and driven regional faunas to extinction, but we were never able to unleash planetary effects before this century's concern with nuclear fallout, ozone holes, and putative global warming. In this context, we are searching for proper themes and language to express our environmental worries. I don't know that paleontology has a great deal to offer, but I would advance one geological insight to combat a well-meaning but seriously flawed and all too common position and to focus attention on the right issue at the proper scale. Two linked arguments are often promoted as a basis for an environmental ethic. One, we live on a fragile planet now subject to permanent derailment and disruption by human intervention. Two, humans must learn to act as stewards for this threatened world. Such views, however well-intentioned, are rooted in the old sin of pride and exaggerated self-importance. We are among millions of species, stewards of nothing. By what argument could we, arising just a geological microsecond ago, become responsible for the affairs of a world 4.5 billion years old, teeming with life that has been evolving and diversifying for at least three quarters of this immense span? Nature does not exist for us, had no idea we were coming, and doesn't give a damn about us. Omar Khayyam was right in all but his crimped view of the Earth as battered when he made his brilliant comparison of our world to an Eastern hotel. Think, in this battered caravanserai, whose portals are alternate night and day, how sultan after sultan with his pomp abode his destined hour and went away. This assertion of ultimate impotence could be countered if we, despite our late arrival, now held the power over the planet's future. But we don't, despite popular misperception of our might. We are virtually powerless over the Earth at our planet's own geological timescale. All the megatonnage in all our nuclear arsenals yields but 1/10,000th the power of the 10-kilometer asteroid that might have triggered the Cretaceous mass extinction. Yet the Earth survived that larger shock and, in wiping out dinosaurs, paved a road for the evolution of large mammals, including humans. We fear global warming, yet even the most radical model yields an Earth far cooler than many happy and prosperous times of a pre-human past. We can surely destroy ourselves and take many other species with us, but we can barely dent bacterial diversity and will surely not remove many million species of insects and mites. On geological scales, our planet will take good care of itself and let time clear the impact of any human malfeasance. People who do not appreciate the fundamental principle of appropriate scales often misread such an argument as a claim that we may therefore cease to worry about environmental deterioration, just as Copeland argued falsely that we need not fret about extinction. But I raise the same counter-argument. We cannot threaten at geological scales, but such vastness has no impact upon us. We have a legitimately parochial interest in our own lives, the happiness and prosperity of our children, the suffering of our fellows. The planet will recover from nuclear holocaust, but we will be killed and maimed by billions, and our cultures will perish. The Earth will prosper if polar ice caps melt under a global greenhouse, but most of our major cities, built at sea level as ports and harbors, will founder, and changing agricultural patterns will uproot our populations. We must squarely face an unpleasant historical fact. The conservation movement was born, in large part, as an elitist attempt by wealthy social leaders to preserve wilderness as a domain for patrician leisure and contemplation, against the image, so to speak, of poor immigrants traipsing in hordes through the woods with their Sunday picnic baskets. We have never entirely shaken this legacy of environmentalism as something opposed to immediate human needs, particularly of the impoverished and unfortunate. But the Third World expands and contains most of the pristine habitat that we yearn to preserve. Environmental movements cannot prevail until they convince people that clean air and water, solar power, recycling, and reforestation are best solutions, as they are, for human needs at human scales, and not for impossibly distant planetary futures. I have a decidedly unradical suggestion to make about an appropriate environmental ethic, one rooted with this entire essay in the issue of appropriate human scale versus the majesty but irrelevance of geological time. I have never been much attracted to the Kantian categorical imperative in searching for an ethic, to moral laws that are absolute and unconditional, and do not involve any ulterior motive or end. The world is too complex and sloppy for such uncompromising attitudes, and God help us if we embrace the wrong principle and then fight wars, kill and maim, in our absolute certainty. I prefer the messier, hypothetical imperatives that invoke desire, negotiation, and reciprocity. Of these lesser but altogether wiser and deeper principles, one has stood out for its independent derivation, with different words, but to the same effect, in culture after culture. I imagine that our various societies grope towards this principle, because structural stability and basic decency necessary for any tolerable life demand such a maxim. Christians call this principle the Golden Rule. Plato, Hillel, and Confucius knew the same maxim by other names. I cannot think of a better principle based on enlightened self-interest. If we all treated others as we wish to be treated ourselves, then decency and stability would have to prevail. I suggest that we execute such a pact with our planet. She holds all the cards and has immense power over us. So such a compact, which we desperately need but she does not at her own timescale, would be a blessing for us and an indulgence for her. We had better sign the papers while she is still willing to make a deal. If we treat her nicely, she will keep us going for a while. If we scratch her, she will bleed, kick us out, bandage up, and go about her business at her own scale. Poor Richard told us that necessity never made a good bargain, but the Earth is kinder than human agents in the art of the deal. She will uphold her end. We must now go and do likewise. 3. Losing a limpet. Darwin marveled at the abundance of giant Galapagos tortoises when he visited the islands in September 1835, but he also noted a marked decline based on ease of human exploitation for food. Ships would often take tortoises away by the hundreds, stacking them live in the hold to provide months of fresh meat on the hoof. The tortoises were essentially defenseless. As a single barrier to capture, Darwin notes that ships usually sent out hunting parties in pairs, and two men could not lift the largest animals. Darwin wrote in The Voyage of the Beagle, "It is said that formerly single vessels have taken away as many as 700 of these animals, and that the ship's company of a frigate some years since brought down 200 to the beach in one day." The species, though not threatened as a whole, is much depleted today, and several distinctive forms, once limited to single islands, have disappeared. I saw the saddest story of this legacy, Lonesome George, last survivor of the saddle-backed race from Pinta Island. No mate has been found for George, though the island has been scoured. He has been moved, for safekeeping, and in apparently vain hope for salvation of his kind, to a research station on Santa Cruz Island, where I saw him several years ago. He is well fed and surely pampered, and he may live for another century or more, but his lineage, at least as a pure pedigree, is already extinct. Every George must have his Martha. The last passenger pigeon, also a mateless vestige of a doomed race, died in the Cincinnati Zoo on September 1, 1914. Martha's body was taken to the Cincinnati Ice Company, suspended in a tank of water, frozen into a 300-pound block of ice, and sent for extrication and stuffing to the Smithsonian Institution, where she resides today. Galapagos tortoises were vulnerable and restricted in geography. Their extreme reduction and partial extinction merits no special surprise. But how could the superabundant and widespread passenger pigeon crash and die within a century? By some estimates, they were once the most common bird in America. They migrated in huge flocks over most of eastern and central North America. Pioneer ornithologist Alexander Wilson estimated one such aggregation as containing more than 2 billion birds. One colony in Wisconsin spread out over 750 square miles. The famous testimony of Audubon himself, made in Ohio just 100 years before Martha's death, not only identifies human rapacity as the cause of eventual decline, but also depicts the fabulous abundance. As the time of the arrival of the passenger pigeons approached, their foes anxiously prepared to receive them. Some persons were ready with iron pots containing sulfur, others with torches of pine knots, many had poles, and the rest, guns. Everything was ready, and all eyes were fixed on the clear sky that could be glimpsed amid the tall treetops. Suddenly, a general cry burst forth, "Here they come!" The noise they made, even though still distant, reminded me of a hard gale at sea passing through the rigging of a close-reefed vessel. The birds arrived and passed over me. I felt a current of air that surprised me. Thousands of pigeons were soon knocked down by the Pullman, whilst more continued to pour in. The fires were lighted, then a magnificent, wonderful, almost terrifying sight presented itself. The pigeons arriving by...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.